Hello and welcome to the new episode on DNS, Domain Name System. In this session, we'll try to understand what are called host names followed by domain names and how domain names are being translated to the IP addresses of the host. To understand, let us begin with one simple example. By this time, many of you are aware of how do we get the information which is present on the Moodle servers. So for this, you are entering a URL known as Uniform Resource Locator, like entering https://, followed by scis-learn1.uhyd.ac.in. So this particular string has got several attributes. There is a several information is available on this particular set of characters. So here we use this set of characters, which is a string which resembles some important information. So in this string, there are two important things called as the host name and the domain name. What is a domain name? A domain name is basically your website name, like the one scislearn1.uhyd.ac.in or simply uhyd.ac.in, and it is also nothing but an address where the internet users access your website for knowing the information which is available on that particular servers. So these domain names will be mostly useful for finding the computers which are connected over the internet. So it will help us to identify the computer which is across the internet to exchange some information. So the entire string, the set of characters, what you see here when you enter it on the browser is nothing but basically contains the domain name from where you will try to retrieve some information. In this string, there is another important information which you call it as a host name. So a host name is a label that is assigned to a device connected in a computer network. So it is basically something like a tag which has been assigned to a computer, which can easily identify, which provides us some related information which is available on that particular computer or on that particular host on that particular network. So the host name will identify the device connected in various forms of electronic communication. So let us quickly understand what is this particular Uniform Resource Locator contains. So if you see from the left to right, the first thing that you observe here is HTTPS Hypertext Transfer Protocol Security. It's basically a protocol, a set of rules that are need to be followed in retrieving the information or in exchange of information from this particular host. So what is this HTTP all about? We'll come to know in the due course of our study. So at present, please try to make an understanding that this is nothing but basically a protocol which is made use to retrieve some information which is available on a particular device at a different location. So scis-learn1 is basically what we term as the subdomain which is under the domain of UHYD. So under UHYD organization, under particular community or under this particular domain, you have a subdomain, scis-learn1. Similarly, you have scis-learn2. And another example, scis. So there are several other subdomains which are available on this particular domain. So that the subdomain or the domain name constitutes basically your host name. And please do remember, when your domain is connected over the internet or your computer or your server, which is made available on the internet, should be unique. So the domain names are very unique when they are being accessed over the internet. And followed by this host name, you will see something else here. There is nothing but we call it as top level domain. Top level domain, TLD. So this top level domain, which is at the right end of this string, which indicates that this particular set of devices are under this particular domain. So here CC stands for country code, So there are different set of top level domains. Categorically, there are a different for different purposes, for different various users, we have different types of top level domains. So one such is your generic top level domain is another one. And in that process, we have with respect to the country, under the country, again, you have several academic institutions. That's the AC stands for, which is a second level domain, which is under the tree of the country, and followed by the corresponding domains, which are again under this particular hierarchical structure. So what are host names? Basically, a host name is a label that is assigned to a device connected in a computer network. And please do remember, these host names must be unique, because this particular device is going to be connected over the internet, and this needs to be unique so that you can easily identify and retrieve the information. So in order to have this unique names for your host names, and to scalable to have more number of such kind of unique names, how do we achieve this scalability of having different host names? The scalability can be achieved by following a hierarchical principle. So we introduce a hierarchy in the form of a tree structure, and the tree structure will enable us to give unique names for different set of devices which are connected over the internet. Underneath the top level domain country codes, we have something like a different set of second level domains which are pertaining to each country, such as academic institutions, the government institutions, the organizations, and so on and so forth. These are being termed under the second level domains. And under each second level domain, you have the actual organizational domain names, such as University of Hyderabad, which are again pertaining to the academic institutions. Similarly, IIT Hyderabad, which is again comes under the hierarchical structure of the second level domain AC, Usmania, which is also again comes under the second level domain AC, so on and so forth. Of course, many of the URLs which you see, which can be related to AC, some of the education institutions do have the EDU nomenclature, but the main difference between EDU and AC, it depends from country to country. So some countries treat EDU as educational institutions, and some countries do consider AC as some research institution. So under the domain of University of Hyderabad, you have computer, the labeled name SCIS Learn 1, SCIS Learn 2, SCIS, so on and so forth. So these computers are nothing but basically the host where a lot of information is being available, and these informations are been categorically divided, and they have been made available at different hosts. And all these hosts are being connected to this particular domain. And under this domain, they are being categorically accessed by following the hierarchical structure from the root. So why this particular type of hierarchical structure has come into picture? So this is the main advantage of this hierarchical structure to be followed for the appropriate domain names is that to have a distribution across different entities. And that distribution will make us to have unique names. So here, this hierarchical structure creates different set of levels, and that levels will enable us to allocate some set of domains as well as the corresponding hosts to those corresponding domains in a very easy manner. So what you are seeing is basically the country code top level domain. That's what I have given here. And you have in general top level domains such as .com, .orgs, .net, .edu, .gov, .military. These are the initial set of top level domains which during the time of ARPANET, the particular corresponding domain names have come into picture. These are in general. So now coming to the tree of all host names, which starts with a dot followed by the different set of top level domains, which can be shown here, depicted here, which are a set of general top level domains, followed by country code top level domains. Under each that particular top level domains, you have a set of different second level domains, and followed by the corresponding the domain names and their host names. Now, how do we translate the names into addresses? Please do remember, computers are being addressed with the numbers. That is what your internet protocol number IP, either IPv4 or IPv6. But users of the internet cannot remember these IP numbers easily. So what we need to do is, we can easily identify those hosts by their names. So there must be a process to translate the domain names into the corresponding IP addresses of the host, so that that particular systems can be easily accessible for exchange of information. So in order to efficiently translate a host name, you can do either have a centralized database which collects or which can host 1 billion host names, all of them together at one particular place, a centralized database. But in practice, this is not possible. So what we try to go for is a distributed database, where the distributed database follows the procedure of domain name system. We have a hierarchy of domain names which follows certain tree structure to easily address the respective hosts, and the corresponding IP addresses can be easily retrieved, so that the exchange of information takes place between the machines with the help of IP addresses. So please do remember, the names are basically, it is meant for the users to remember them and make use of them with a proper understanding. Whereas in practice, the machines do communicate with each other with the help of IP addresses only. So in order to translate a name to an IP address or an IP address to the corresponding name, a procedure is being developed, and that procedure is being incorporated. That procedure name is basically called as domain name system, and this is one of the application layer protocol mechanism which takes care of translating a name to an IP address and an IP address to a name. So the domain name service or the domain name system is basically a server, is responsible for a domain, and it keeps the IP addresses of all the host names in that particular domain. So if you look here, that academic, under the academic institutions, the sub second level of top level domains, we have different universities, and that university is nothing but a physically a domain, and that domain keeps tracks of all the IP addresses of that corresponding host in that particular domain. So the IP address of the domain name server is responsible for keeping the subdomains, and so on and so forth. So a domain name service is responsible for knowing all the host IP addresses of that particular corresponding domain. The domain here is the University of California, UCL. Under that university, if there are certain machines or the host www or info or math department, so on and so forth, each department has got a corresponding machine, the host machine, which we call it as, or the host, which can provide information related to the respective department. And the domain here is basically the UCL, which keeps track of all the IP addresses of the machines. So how do we translate a domain name into an IP address? So there is, of course, there are a particular procedure need to be incorporated, and that procedure is something similar to this. So let us understand with an example. Suppose you need to find out what is the IP address of google.com. The IP address of the google.com, assume you are on the client machine or on a particular machine which is connected across the internet. Now that machine does not know the IP address of google.com. So how this machine is trying to get the IP address of google.com, so that that machine can talk to that google.com for exchange of information. Step one, what the end user operating system is trying to do is, that operating system generates a query to a particular machine. That machine, we call it as a DNS resolver. This DNS resolver is another server, a one kind of server which do exist at your internet service provider. So a machine which is connected on the internet through an internet service provider, a query is being raised, and the query is being passed onto this DNS resolver to find out what is the address of google.com. So if in case this DNS resolver, which is present at your ISP service provider or the internet service provider, if that particular service provider's DNS resolver do not have the IP address of google.com, The request is further passed on to the next another set of servers. So here in this case, what if suppose the DNS resolver do not have the IP address, the request is being passed on to another server. The name of that server, we usually call it as root name server. The root name server do maintain the list of all the name servers that are made available on the tree host name hierarchical structure. So that root name server, if that particular, obviously the root name server will not have the google.com's IP address, but the request has come from the DNS resolver. So the root name server's responsibility is to now give the response whether if there is an IP address, the IP address will be given. Otherwise, the information is again sent back to the DNS resolver stating that the particular address of that particular string, that is the google.com, which contains .com value and which is again .com, which is related to the top level domain name. So the top level domain names IP addresses can be found out with another name server called as top level domain name server. So the response from the root name server is sent back to the DNS resolver, and now the DNS resolver will have the IP address of the top level domain name servers. So the top level level domain name servers, again the request has come from the DNS resolver to find out what is the address of google.com. So the .com, obviously all the .com organizations do keep track of, or their informations or their IP addresses of that organizations are keep track of their information at the top level domain name servers. So once the request has come to DNS resolver, this TLD, top level domain name server, will give the IP address of the corresponding organizational, that is the domain name or the domain IP address of that organization, that is in this case here, that is the Google. So the response from the TLD name server is that the IP address of the Google domain is being given to this DNS resolver. So the, once the IP address of the Google domain name is known, then the DNS resolver sends a request to the Google name server. The Google name server now knows the IP addresses of its corresponding web server. So that corresponding information is being passed on to the DNS resolver. So the Google web server's information IP address is been known to your DNS resolver, and then it is passed on to the requested end user operating system, so that that host system can now talk to the Google web server for getting the information accordingly. So these are all the steps usually happens in a fraction of a second. So there will be a time to live. Of course, the data structures, the mechanisms, the methods are, I have not discussed it more elaborately here, but I assume that for the students of internet technologies, just to have an idea about this information, how the domain name corresponding IP address is being known to the corresponding host. Please do remember there are these root name servers and the top level level domain name servers are being kept across the internet, so they are made available across the nations. And as such, there are root name servers, around 13 such root name servers are available, which are being maintained by different organizations. So much information you can get it from the our reference material. So please keep. As we have seen in the previous slide, how a domain name system translates into a corresponding IP address, that is a basic procedure. So the DNS resolver usually implements the domain name system protocol, and which is one of the application layer protocol. To do all that process, the host names do contact with the corresponding the web servers or the servers which are present across the internet to exchange some information. So with this idea of the DNS and the host names, what are called domain names and so on and so forth, let us see one example how we can try to find out what is the IP address of a corresponding domain name and vice versa.